On today's show,
inspired by Powerball fever, we debate the probability of Kawhi Leonard winning MVP as well as the Knicks making the playoffs.
In Crossfire, we discuss who should be the Nets' next coach and if doing the mailman is actually cool.
And hashtag NBA vote Zaza Pachulia. Yes, it's a thing and we're on board.
It's Wednesday, January 13th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or catching us on NBA TV and or YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Taz Mellis.
Good luck tonight. Hope you're watching this on a huge TV tomorrow.
To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele. Last, certainly not least, over at the internet, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Heyo!
Heyo!
TK, what do you got for us today?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters. And guys, yesterday we launched our campaign to get into the All-Star Celebrity Game. We asked everybody at home to tweet hashtag NBA Celebrity Vote, and y'all came through in a major way. We're not talking about one or two or 10 or 50 tweets. We're talking about hundreds upon hundreds. So I thought it would be fun to take a look at some of the best tweets we saw. This one comes from Chuck, who says, let's forget the ISO ball and get some very solid plays in the Celebrity Game.
My
send the
man,
starters.
Chuck. Yeah. Yep.
He knows what's up. Edward says, I haven't missed an NBA All-Star Celebrity Game since 2003. Weird. Prepare to boycott. If the starters aren't in it,
wow,
so are others.
Whoa.
hundreds of others.
Yeah. Chris Morgan says, if you want the world to be truly beautiful and truly just, the starters must be in the Celebrity Game. 100% accurate. Chloe Schmoe says, send the starters home so we can have ourselves a game.
Yeah, nice.
100% agree, Chloe. And my favorite comes from Preston, who simply says, get the starters in or we riot.
Yes.
Not the only person to say that. Just a reminder, though, nobody is actually counting these tweets or tabulating them. But get your tweets in. It's our only chance. Hashtag NBA Celebrity Vote.
All right. Great
awesome
stuff. All right. We got a fun show tonight. Tass, you already alluded to it. Tonight, lots of hype surrounding the 1.5 billion Powerball draw. It's going to be huge. Have you got a ticket, Lee?
I have, and I'm going to buy an NBA team with my winnings.
Well, bad news for you here. Your odds of winning extremely low. I think it's something like each ticket one in 292.2 million.
So you're saying you never know. Chance.
No, there's not much of a chance. The probability of becoming a billionaire after tonight is very low, but who cares? It's inspired a new segment here on The Starters. We're going to have some fun with this, guys. I'm going to throw an NBA hypothetical your way. And on a scale of one Powerball to six Powerballs, you're gonna decide just how good the odds of it happening are, all right? So one Powerball low, six Powerballs, I mean, that's what you want tonight if you're playing, very, very high. All right, first one, it's no secret, Spurs forward, Kawhi Leonard. He's having an exceptional season.
He sure is.
Right, he's on one of the best teams in the Spurs. His numbers, all career highs. He's coming off the Defensive Player of the Year. His defense is maybe even better, so he's still a two-way player. I wanna know, what's the probability of Kawhi Leonard winning MVP?
One Powerball.
Ooh.
And that's
low,
it.
Low.
This is the year of Steph Curry. Not to
downplay
what Kawhi Leonard is doing by any means. Mm-hmm. But this is the year of Steph Curry. He is changing the game. Mm-hmm. He is transcendent. This is not the year to have your career highs if you want to win MVP.
Right.
10 points per game is the difference between Steph and Kawhi Leonard. And not to say Kawhi doesn't do a lot on the basketball floor. But voters don't necessarily look at defense. And Kawhi adds a lot on the defensive end, but when you've got a huge gap, like 10 points per game, and you're changing the way defenses play you, you're gonna win MVP.
You agree with this?
I do, because there is an award for Defensive Player of the Year, I don't think that's always taken into account when you have an MVP type season. And again, Kawhi's numbers don't jump off the page at you because of the way they play in San Antonio. If he was to win currently based on his scoring average of around 20 or so a game, that would be the lowest mark, not including Steve Nash, who we knew was more of a point guard who got a lot more assists, since Dave Cowens in 1973.
Okay.
So those are the sorts of things that I think will become a factor, but Kawhi is having an unbelievable season.
Let me throw this hypothetical at you, though. What if the Spurs
have a better record?
What if the Spurs have a better record at the end of the season than the Warriors? You still don't think that will really matter?
We're almost at the midway point, and the Warriors have two losses. So if they have 15, 16, 18 left, they go 62-20, I still think he gets it. I think it's a reasonable question to ask if Kawhi is going to be on the All-NBA first team with Kevin Durant.
Right.
And LeBron James at the forward spots. That's a legit.
Well, that was going to be a sort of a follow-up question. If it's not Kawhi and he's got very low chances, as we see, one Powerball, let's say, to win MVP, is there someone that you would put at three, four Powerballs out of the scale of six here? Is it LeBron? Durant, Westbrook?
For me...
Are they higher than Kawhi is what I'm saying?
I don't know about higher. I think they're all about... They're sort of jostling for that second position. I mean, Kevin Durant, we know he's a brilliant player as well. And coming off the season he had last year, he's really trying to show that he's back to that MVP of two seasons ago. But I don't think anyone's ahead of Kawhi at this point.
All right, next one here, guys. Despite losing Carmelo Anthony last night to a bum ankle in a very weird play, he stepped on a referee's foot while he was going back down the court. The Knicks, without him really in that second half, beat the Celtics last night. 120-114. The win brings New York to 500 on the season with an optometrist's favorite record of 20-20. So, guys, what's the probability of the Knicks making the playoffs this season? Again, on our Powerball scale.
Yeah, six Powerballs. I'm going to give the Knicks a 2.
That's it.
Yeah, that's it. The Eastern Conference is very good. I predicted that they'd make it before the season.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised. Well, you're only going 2.
It sounded like a dumb pick before the season. It sounds like an okay pick now, but the Eastern Conference playoff race is very, very tough. Mm-hmm. I didn't expect the Pistons to be this good, and they're in the 7th spot. 7 and up, I think, are locks. I think Pacers, Heat, and Pistons are in. That puts the Knicks in a battle with the Magic, Celtics, Wizards, and Hornets. So we got 5 teams vying for 1 spot, in my opinion. And yeah, the Knicks are hot, that's for sure, but all those other teams are very solid basketball teams. What if Porzingis hits a rookie wall at some point?
Right.
And I know the Celtics aren't playing well, but the numbers say they are a better team than the New York Knicks. 2 of 6, in my opinion, 33% chance when we're talking about 5 teams, is very good if we're looking at the math. Math sucks. However, that is a good statistic. I think they're in a good spot, and we're sort of overwhelmed by how good this team is this fast. We didn't expect it, but I can't give them more than that.
I think they're probably 3 or 4 myself, because those teams that they're battling with, the Pistons, Heat, Pacers, Celtics and Magic, they've got 9 games to go. They're only 3-5 against them, but I think they're starting to show, especially with Porzingis there, they're a lot more rounded than they were at the start of the season.
Lee, you came into the office this morning and you were glowing because of Kristaps Porzingis' game last night.
I wanted them in every segment.
I mean, you got zing fever.
I absolutely have. And I'm not afraid to admit it, because he has been so good. His offensive game is mature well beyond his years. He's so confident. He can do that little left-handed hook shot, almost like a Pau Gasol move down low. He stepped out. He hit a 3-pointer from Steph Curry range last night.
He did.
He goes inside. He's got good handles. I mean,
he's great.
If you're a Knicks fan, you're going to be very excited with what you're seeing with him.
He's going to go to All-Star Weekend.
Yeah, he'll be there.
The media is going to be yanking him all around. Yeah. He's going to get tired.
He's going to get tired
in the second half. Where is he going to hit that rookie wall?
Most rookies do hit a wall at some point. We know Wiggins last year actually got better as the second half went on. I think Porzingis is actually going to keep improving.
He's going to get Chris stopped by that rookie wall at some point.
But there is such a logjam. I mean, we showed you the standings. It's something like 4.5 games separating the 5th seed from the 12th seed. And you can even throw the Bucks at the 13th seed into the mix here now, only 1 game behind the Hornets. So there's so many of these squads that I think 2 or 3 Powerballs sounds about right here with the next chances of getting in there, because there's just so many squads. I mean, you see a team like the Wizards, they get an injury to Beal and suddenly they sort of fall off, but he's coming back soon. Do they turn it around?
And they're a great
team. Same things for other teams.
And the Celtics, they're probably in the best position to acquire somebody at the trade deadline. Right. Somebody's going to jump out from all those teams. We expected the Charlotte Hornets after their start to be in there. There are a lot of good teams down there.
All right, next one here, guys. Anthony Davis, he missed his 2nd straight game against the Lakers last night. He has the lower back contusion. The Pelicans fell to the mighty Lakers, 95-91. It was the 5th game AD has missed this season. He's averaging, though, 23 points per game, nearly 11 rebounds per game, 2.5 blocks, something like that, for an 11-26 team. So the question I have for you, what is the probability of Anthony Davis making the 2016 All-Star game? What do you think?
I've only got him down as 2 balls, because it's a measure of just how good a player he is. You mentioned his stats there, 23, 11, and 2.5 blocks.
Oof.
But the perception is he's not having a great season because the Pelicans have struggled, and he was a little bit slow to get out of the blocks as well. The West front court is also very, very deep. Assuming
stacked.
Right now the starters, we've got Kobe, Draymond, and Kevin Durant based on the votes. Then you've got guys like Kawhi, Blake, Dirk, and DeMarcus, who he's battling with to get that 5th spot in the West front court.
And Zaza Pachulia. We'll talk about him later.
Blake and Dirk, for me, both their teams are over 500, and Dirk is having a very good season. Blake's out right now. Blake, DeMarcus, and Anthony Davis have all missed time. But when it comes down to numbers, I think DeMarcus is a slightly better than Anthony Davis, and the record for Sacramento helps. And I think record should and does count as well.
Yeah, but coaches are going to prefer to take Anthony Davis over DeMarcus Cousins, and that's who picks the backups. The West took 6 front court players last year. He's 6th in voting right now. I think he's going to make it just because he is known as a young superstar, and this is a guy that opposing coaches have to game plan for. The one guy on the floor, really.
Yeah.
Well, there's only 2 guys averaging 20 and 10 this year, and it is DeMarcus and Anthony Davis.
Right.
But just based on, again, like the Mavericks have surprised us where they are, and the Clippers have been fantastic. Blake, before he got injured, was playing incredible basketball as well.
I think Rajon Rondo might steal a few of DeMarcus's votes as well, just because you're probably only going to take one Sacramento King if you do take one. And AD, I think you're right, Trey. He is in the minds of the All-Star coaches as a star, no matter what that situation is. And it is bad in New Orleans. They have the easiest schedule.
Yeah, they just lost to the Lakers.
Yeah.
Told you that.
Oh, yeah. They have the easiest schedule in January. They have 7 teams coming into their house on the second half of back-to-backs. They should be romping, and they're not. It's really odd to see that. Dirk, you mentioned, I think he wants the weekend off. He'll probably
always wants the weekend off, but he's going.
Yeah, yes, last year he was an injury replacement. He doesn't want to be that again.
No, I think he's going.
It would almost be weird in a weird way if Anthony Davis wasn't picked by the coaches. Because, you know, he makes it that in the 1 year where he gets picked as a replacement, and you're just like, look, he's going to be going to the next 15 of these.
It feels that way.
If he can stay
healthy. Expectations on him coming in this season were so high that 23-11, 2.5 doesn't look great, because we thought he was going
to
be 28-15.
It really comes down to whether or not the coaches say, look, your team's like 11-30, we're not taking a guy off your team. That's what it comes down to. Let's hear from you guys on Twitter, though. We got to take a break. When we come back, oh yeah, Tass and I step into the crossfire.
Crossfire, this is how it works. Trey will give Skeets and me 3 topics. We will debate each one. At you at home will declare the winner on Twitter. Trey, let's tell them how it works.
Yeah, if you're following along on Twitter and you think Tass is winning, tweet hashtag Tass wins. If you think Skeets is winning, tweet hashtag Skeets wins.
That's
each tweet counts, so tweet early, tweet often. And let's begin round one. Over the weekend, the Brooklyn Nets reassigned their GM and fired their coach, leaving a couple vacancies at the top. Who should be the next head coach of the Brooklyn Nets? Here we go.
Oh, I don't think anyone would want this job right now.
Come on.
I will say I'd love to see Jeff Van Gundy coach the Brooklyn Nets.
Ooh, interesting.
It's been too long since we've had Jeff Van Gundy behind the bench, nearly a decade. I think he's got experience, of course, with the New York media. He's already coached the Knicks, so he's got Brooklyn there. And I cannot think of a better T-shirt to sell than the notorious JVG in Brooklyn. Of all places.
That's
with Biggie
nice.
Smalls being raised. It just makes sense. Get me JVG.
You're trying to sell T-shirts or get a coach. This guy doesn't want to coach. He hasn't coached in 9 years. As much as I love JVG, there's a guy who's itching to get back in, and that's Tom Thibodeau. You know that he has been itching since he's been let go by the Chicago Bulls last season. And one of Prokhorov's objectives that he mentioned on Monday in his press conference was that he wanted the front office and coaches to be in line with each other, to be speaking to each other. And Tom Thibodeau has learned since the Chicago Bulls days to learn to work with the front office. Yes, he has. Hey, this is going to be his second coaching gig. You learn from your first one. I think he can. Let's give Tom Thibodeau a chance. He wants to coach right now.
Make JVG the GM and the coach, like his brother Stan.
He's got a cushy TV job like us.
Time for round two. Couple of crazy incidents in the league last night. Robin Lopez played nearly an entire minute without one of his shoes, and Zach LaVine made a shot off the top of the backboard after getting fouled on a dunk. Didn't count, still a crazy shot. I need you to tell me, what was the crazier thing that happened? Robin Lopez losing a shoe or Zach LaVine's shot? Here we go.
Robin Lopez played a full minute of NBA basketball without a shoe. That is crazy.
Why?
There's
is crazy?
A lot of crazy things about it. First off,
he doesn't jump as it is. What does it matter?
Well, he did jump, as a matter of fact. He tried to block a shot. It didn't work out. No one gave him his shoe back. Listen, Robin Lopez can sit back on offense. He doesn't have to run up. That's crazy. He didn't fall over while attempting to block a shot. That's crazy. The Celtics didn't go to Amir Johnson to go at Robin Lopez. That's crazy. And at the end, he slipped it on instead of tying it like an athletic shoe
they
should be
tied.
They all
do that now. They all do
that.
That's
why it slipped
crazy.
Off, Robin.
We see guys lose shoes all the time. Nothing crazy about that. Zach LaVine's shot, which wasn't really a shot, as Trey said, because it didn't count. This is nuts. He's on the fast break. Durant clocks him. The thing goes way up in the air, and it actually hits like a wire above the backboard. They looked at it for a long time and said, well, I think the wire's out of bounds, so we can't count this. Still crazy. That has got to be Gotta be the pick for this one. What are the people doing on Twitter right now?
Didn't count.
Oh, looks like a close one going into the third round, our final round, and LeBron James is on an incredible dunk streak right now, and last night he brought back Karl Malone's signature behind-the-head dunk. I know vote, but I need you to tell me, is Karl Malone's mailman dunk cool or uncool? Here we go!
This dunk has got a bad rap. Some people don't like Karl Malone, his game is boring. This dunk is versatile. And it's simple. Versatile because anyone can do this. If you dunk on a 7-foot net, you can put the hand on the back of your head and throw it down. You're dunking on a garbage can, you can throw the hand on the back of your head. People use this at parties while they're enjoying an adult beverage. It's cool. Who cares about the mailman being a boring player in someone's eyes? It's versatile. It's simple.
Here's
why
it's not cool. Here's why it's not cool. It's uncool for this reason. If you're gonna do the mailman dunk, you gotta go all in on being the mailman, all right? LeBron, last I checked, you're not wearing a cool 10-gallon hat, and you're not riding a motorcycle with your MVP hardware with no sleeves, and you don't have a monster truck. All right, he doesn't work out like this. Like, he doesn't wear that, at least, when he's working out. He works out, but he doesn't wear that. So come on, if you're gonna do the mailman's dunk, you gotta go all in.
You gotta wear a hat.
That's right.
There's a dress code.
You gotta go mountain goat hunting.
LeBron James is showing off his hairline. He doesn't need a hat.
Kill some mountain goats.
All right, all right. Our winner is Taskmaster.
Yeah.
But I will say, Skeets is right. Not a cool dunk. Not a cool dunk at all.
Thank you. All right. I'm worse at Crossfire than I am pick'em playoff. All right, we gotta take a break when we come back. Oh, man. Hashtag NBA vote. Zaza Pachulia. Yeah, this is a thing. We're going to have some fun.
Welcome back to the show. On Friday, we discussed the second returns for All-Star voting, and we had some questions. Mainly, how is Zaza Pachulia, a 13-year NBA center who has never been close to being an All-Star, that high on the Western Conference voting scale, a higher than DeMarcus Cousins, Dwight Howard, and his teammate Dirk Nowitzki. Here's a clip of us talking about it.
Zaza Pachu, Leah, has more votes than DeMarcus Cousins. Is this a trend or a dead end?
Oh, please, Mercy, let this be a dead end. I love you, Zaza, but no, this doesn't make sense. Number one, we don't want Zaza in the All-Star game over DeMarcus Cousins. Not that he's going to be a starter. It just doesn't make sense. And number two, it's DeMarcus. This is just crazy.
This is DeMarcus Cousins.
This is one of the best bigs in the league. I don't know how Zaza got there. Is it
Georgia?
Georgian backing?
It's Georgia, yeah.
What is the population of Georgia? Not the state of Georgia, the country of Georgia. And that seemingly angered every single person in the country of Georgia. Because if you looked at the starters Facebook page, facebook.com/thestarters, these are all people from Georgia getting angry at the starters.
This is a tiny, there were thousands
more.
They're still coming in.
But every outlet in Georgia has been showing their support for Zaza. This is Georgia's Got Talent. If you see their hashtag NBA vote in Zaza Pachulia's name, even the president of Georgia, yes, the president of Georgia, Yorgi Margasvili, even tweeted it.
Is this real?
Yeah.
This is real, man.
Yeah. And
what
this is a video of, it looks like some of the Georgian military and some kids giving their support for Zaza Pachulia. Look, we're sorry. We apologize.
Sort of.
Yeah.
And to make it up to you, we decided to put together the top five plays from Zaza Pachulia's entire 13-year career. At number five, it's Zaza Pachulia getting named to the 2016 All-Star team. No, it's not. It's him passing the ball behind his back.
That was nice.
To Marvin Williams for the dunk.
This is an olive branch to the people
sort of
Georgia.
Yeah.
Showing you the Zaza top five. Well, at number four, we're going to the preseason.
Oh, yeah.
Zaza Pachulia, the huge offensive rebound, and then he turns into Kobe Bryant.
Oh, yeah.
And ends the first quarter. Yes, the first quarter with the buzzer beater.
Money!
First quarter, the most important quarter in basketball, some say.
Certainly.
I just said.
Another preseason game. Here she is. Zaza gets fouled, flicks it up.
Oh.
It's good.
And one.
He must be a great horse player.
Yeah, you're probably right. All right, forget the preseason. Let's go to the playoffs. Last year, remember this play? Zaza gets the D up in the air, draws the foul, and hits the crazy
shot. Another and one.
as he falls down. He's the king of the N1, you're right. I'm all in. Give me my phone.
Hashtag NBA vote.
Sauce on Pachulia.
But at number one, 2008, the best Zaza moment. After winning game six against the Celtics in round one, Zaza took the mic.
Nothing easy. Nothing easy. We're going to game seven, baby. Game seven. Game seven. Hey, I wish you guys were there, but we everybody knows that. We got your support. We're going to feel it on game seven. We love you. Woo!
We're friends again.
Woo!
We're friends with you, Georgians.
We love you, Georgia.
Woo!
We love you, Georgia. All right, gotta take a break. One more when we come back. Lili's very solid play of the night. Did Zaza play last night?
Have to wait and see.
Did he play? I can't remember.
He did.
All right. Back with the starters. Trey, the only one to pick up a win last night. Nice 5-1 overall record. You see tonight's play, we're all taking the Blazers at home to the Utah Jazz. I'm a little surprised all of us taking Portland, but there it is. That game, 10 p.m. on NBA League Pass. Lili, where are we going for the very solid play?
We're going to Dallas and we have a new category.
What?
We've already have the triple-double. Well, now we have the double-triple, a.k.a. the Reggie Miller. Delavadova knocks down a three, gets the steal, gets it back, knocks down another three. That's 6 points in 8 seconds. Not quite Reggie, but pretty close to it. Here it is again.
What'd you call
Here's
it?
The first three.
A double triple.
A double triple. Gets that. Then he gets the steal like Reggie got off Greg Anthony.
Yeah.
Now he gets saves the ball, gets it back, knocks down another three. All happened in 8 seconds. That's what I call a very solid play.
Nice.
That's nice, man. I like that one.
That's a really nice one. All right, Lee, I think we finally have some times. Oh, we're out of time.
Oh.
I was going to say, I forgot about this. We're going to get to some fan signs in a second, but we got a game tomorrow.
Here on the network.
Raptors, Magic, 3 p.m. Is that a typo? No. They're playing in London, England. So catch that again here on NBA TV, 3 p.m. Eastern. Nice Photoshop there, by the way, the Abbey Road. Lee, fan signs.
Yeah, ton of fan signs. The first one comes from Ceylan Singh and her friend in Portland. Good to have some ladies with some signs. We need more of those. The next one's from William Masters. He and his friend put this piece together. They were in Washington over the weekend. The next one comes from Jobba99 in LA. Came up with a nice sign there. Even had the Lakers swear jar. Graham Burks also had one really good job there. His friend in Sacramento. Another one from Marilyn Williams. This is a shirt. It's a weird shirt, but he's got the thumbs up. Good job. Braden Rosenfeld in Portland put together this piece. Great job.
Miko and his favorite girl, their own up-down report.
Beauty.
Up-down on the Spurs winning the title, they say. Guess they're Spurs fans.
All right. Great stuff. Thanks for the signs. Keep them coming. Stick around for game time. We'll be back tomorrow, 7 p.m. Eastern.
Thanks for joining us. And remember, the next size up in a shoe could be a half size. You don't got to go fully.
Brace tonight, people.